Israel saw pass judgment on servants of another. It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day observe it in honor of the Lord. Also, those who eat eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. While those who abstain abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, direct reply to Peter's question. It's a story that challenges our human sensibilities for keeping score. The king who goes about settling accounts, yes, represents God, that's pretty clear. And God is the divine source of goodness and grace. God is invested not only in the resources entrusted to each servant for good use, but also in the relationships that reveal our evolving capacity to channel grace. And since this is a symbolic story, as Jesus' parables are, neither Peter nor we can afford to mistake the details that Jesus chooses carefully to help us clue in to where God pays most attention in the end. Because how we treat one another is of utmost importance to God. We see that in the way that the metrics the king applies makes God out to be something of a keen investment banker, measuring the factor of grace that either grows or shrinks with each interpersonal interaction, according to how often we forgive ourselves and one another. Amid the things we do and leave undone, no matter how many times we fail each other. The divine spreadsheet, though, is no tool for piling on shame. Let us pay attention to that. Still, it does hold us accountable for making progress in this spiritual practice. And let's face it, we easily forget God's forgiveness is meant to free us from guilt. We don't just reflect and ruminate on that, those ways we can't forgive ourselves. We also spend a lot of time and energy taking to task those people we feel have done us wrong. Growing in this capacity, this God-given capacity to be multipliers of grace, isn't meant to be some form of mystical calculus, but it does ask us to keep returning to God for help. God doesn't lose track of our earnest prayers. God never has turned one down who has asked for more time for grace to do its healing work. God forgives us so that we, in turn, can forgive ourselves. And this frees us, or it's meant to forgive the ones who trespass against us. I ran into one of St. Paul's unhoused neighbors yesterday. I probably was not the most patient, as we went around the campus and discovered all the treasures he had left for us, including some biohazards. But in my interactions with him, I asked about all these unwieldy belongings that clearly were making it difficult for him to move about in the world. I saw him struggling with this old computer monitor that he had strapped to this walker that had been repurposed into a makeshift cart. He had the plastic tub he'd filled with water from our rose garden in an effort to wash dirty clothes. It was a little overwhelming trying to find a way to be patient and to help. Clearly, I still have a lot to learn. But it made me realize by the end of the day that in some ways, I kind of like this guy. His name is William. I too can be burdened by with these many things that I've accumulated in life, things that remind me I still have a lot to do to open my heart to God's grace. Don't we all have things like that? Jesus knows that it's difficult for all of us, and I think that's why he gave us a specific practice that's meant to invite that grace into our hearts. Built into the very prayer that he taught his friends and then passed on to us, because God forgives our sins just as we forgive those who sin against us. I think this implies that we can be either multipliers or subtractors of grace, depending on if we're willing to receive or if we resist God's forgiveness. Life is going to give us plenty of learning opportunities. We will fail. We can ask God's forgiveness. We can choose to try again. Until we're discovering that we no longer need to keep score. We can trust that grace has simply become part of who we are. The good news is that God shows up when we ask for help. Because God's grace never fails or runs out, no matter how many times we trespass against each other. So returning to this guy in the parable, who was indebted up to his eyeballs, begging his sovereign for more time to
In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear,
for all who have requested the prayers of the St. Paul's community, and all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friends, and the needy.
In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we remember the Church of the Province of the Indian Ocean. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, and Mark, our bishop, and for all ministers of the gospel. Almighty God, giver of every good gift, by your grace you have called us into one fellowship of faith. Look graciously on the people of the Diocese of California during this time of transition. May we be guided in heart and mind by your Holy Spirit to seek and welcome a faithful pastor who will care for your people and equip us to perform the work of the Church. Grant us, in all our doubts and uncertainties, the grace you ask what you would have us do. Save us from all false choices, that in your light we may see light, and on your path may not stumble. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We give thanks for the ministry of music at St. Paul's, especially for all who serve and lead in our choirs. Holy One, inspire their prayerful practice to deepen our shared faith and to draw our neighbors toward your love. Especially in this year's monthly evensong worship, bless our community with glimpses of your goodness and glory. Inspire us to invite those who may be longing to know the renewing joy of your presence.
May our prayers and songs strengthen our trust in God's faithful care for our community.
We will exalt you, O God, our King. Pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them. Let us join in saying together our prayer for mission.
Merciful Father, in your compassion, forgive us our sins.
No.
on September 30th. There will be lunch and dinner that night. We'll also have dinner on Saturday, October 14th, and lunch and dinner on Sunday, October 15th, and then dinner will actually be after our Evensong that day. I've been helping to organize this with Brian Vanderloon. These will all be at people's homes, so please sign up. I'll be outside, so you can sign up today. There was information in the weekly email. There may be information in the bulletins and on the website. If there's not, we'll get that fixed. But please do sign up, and let me just put a plea. Please sign up maybe for something where there are people you don't know, so you get to know some other people. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. As Candace is coming forward, I just want to reiterate there are some of these in the chapel, and there are some of these in the font at the back, so please feel free to avail yourself of them. Candace?
Good morning. I'm Candace Martin. I'm a member of the St. Paul Circle of St. Paul's for over 40 years now. We're pleased to invite you to have some refreshments with us following the service. We hope you'll take a look at our poster board with all kinds of pictures and information about. And also look into your heart and think of ways that you might be able to work in some capacity to help us help others. Thank you.
Thank you, Candace. Thank you to everyone who has been hosting a coffee hour on the third Sunday of the month. We'll be in the Skillings Garden after the service, and I know that the Circle has greatly appreciated all of your donations of your household goods to the rummage sale efforts. The rummage sale, of course, being the first weekend in October, so thank you to the Circle for hosting our coffee today.
Two quick announcements. At the coffee hour, or right back outside, if you haven't grabbed your directory, please do. Correct it if we have your listing wrong. If we don't have your listing and you want to be in it, let us know. There's a piece of paper there and add your listing. We'd love to have you. And two, as you know, we have space for our families usually, and we're going to try something a little different every month. So in addition to children's sermon, we're also going to do a children's chapel around the liturgy of the word. So the minute somebody comes up to read the first lesson, I'm going to maybe have Sarah invite the children to come up. Maybe we'll bless them for their work. And we're going to go to foot hall. And we're going to go into a classroom. And then we're going to break down the story so that they kind of understand it from their perspective. And then we're going to come back. So you may see some children around the altar or around giving the gifts or doing something. And I just want us to be encouraging. So if you see kids here, great. If you don't see them here and they're in your families, encourage them to come. We'll put them in the Friday e-news to let you know that we're going to do a children's chapel. So just tell your family and friends. All right? Thanks.
Thank you, Dawson. You all might have noticed we're singing some new service music this fall. A new song of praise by Unmeets With More, and also some new pieces around the Eucharist by Liam Klin. And if you are like I am still learning these pieces, that's okay. We've got an amazing choir behind us that can help us feel held by the music as we are learning and growing in our ability to join in and that song of praise, that voice of worship, and we'll be living with this music for a while. So it's okay if it takes a minute for it to catch on. I wanted to also lift up this beautiful bookmark that's in the back of the church.
them to know where they are. And if you prefer not to receive the wine, you can just cross your arms over your chest and the person goes by will acknowledge you and will share in this gift of grace, God's love and forgiveness for each and every one of us. So let us walk in that love our Lord has offered as the offering and sacrifice for the whole world.
I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. Till I die, till I die. I will.
source of life, fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing.
tried to follow Jesus and you who have failed, come, because it is Christ who invites us to meet God here.
Thank you.
loving God.